In my last video, which dealt with the testimony of Philipa Kuranchie, that I wanted to share why I support it, and this particular testimony is covering her videos number 4 and 5 of Heaven or Hell, where she shared that the Lord showed her 5 demons that rule the world. The video before, I covered one of the 2 demons that really struck a nerve with me, that really made me passionate about what she testified in support. Now that was about the demon who rules TV, and I shared in detail why it struck a nerve and why I so passionately support what she testified. Now in this video, which is number 2 of why I support Philipa Kuranchie's testimony given in those 2 videos of hers, this one covers the other demon that really struck a nerve with me that she talked about, which was one of the 5 demons that the Lord showed her. It was the very first one, and it was a demon that was huge and gigantic and was the demon over money. And in this video, I'm going to share with you why it struck a nerve, why I so passionately support what she said. And in addition, as I said in the video before, part of that passion had to do with my own encounter of such a principality in this world. And I'm going to share that testimony at the end. That said, now I'm going to take another minute to tell you briefly what Philipa said in the second of the 2 videos. In this other video of her that's connected to this testimony, that she gave the 5 demons rule the world, it actually was the beginning of that testimony, and it's in the video called Heaven or Hell number 4, Sister Philipa Kuranchie at the Heaven Seekers Ministry channel. In this one, it was the very first demon that is the subject of this critique. She went on to say that the Lord showed her very huge and gigantic demon. She said when they went to this place that the Lord took her to see the first of the demons, she said the Lord showed her very huge and gigantic demon, and he was very ugly, and he had an inscription on his forehead, and it was the god of money. Now what struck Philipa about this was something that she asked the Lord. She asked the Lord, why is this demon so huge and gigantic and big? And the image that they showed for this demon, which, you know, is just an artistic image, was an image of a demon that seemed to be all the way up to the clouds. And the Lord told her that every time someone worships money, this makes the demon grow. Now she went on to relate messages that the Lord told her that were important principles concerning that demon and how people behave with money. Now, the key thing about this particular part of her testimony was the giganticness of this demon, the bigness of this demon. This was the thing that was so incredible to hear her say, because it was part of my experience. It was part of my experience. It was a tremendous part of my experience. The giganticness, the bigness of this ruler that I encountered. It was a prevailing part of the experience. It was an awesome part of the experience. It was a feature of the experience. And now, on that, I'm going to take the time then to share it with you so you will understand. You understand what was so significant about her saying that, about how big it is, how powerful it is, how gigantic. And to me, it wasn't just coincidence that she was saying that. It made me get moved in the spirit. You know, I need to share this. I have said it in brief things here and there. You know, I tried this when I first started with this, from growing out from this experience that I had. I didn't have any leadership. I didn't know how to do this. I mean, praise God, Philipa Kuranchie has a spiritual father and a literal father who is steeped in the Word. Her father is a pastor, and he is a great guide to her in her revelation she has been receiving from the Lord. And she has had this wonderful leadership that has helped her to present what she has been encountering. But I haven't had anything like that. I mean, I tried to go to a church with these experiences, but they were afraid. They were afraid that anything had anything to do with demons, that they didn't want to hear about it, they want to do anything about it. And also, I think, you know, the Lord wanted to lead me onto another journey with it, to end up finally developing to a channel that I didn't even know I was going to be doing it. This channel, and going where I'm going now, and the teachings of having to do with holiness and righteousness, and the evangelizing that we're all called to do. But so I didn't know how to present it. I didn't even know what to do about it. But I needed to present it because it's so powerful. For the very reasons the Lord told Philippa, the world needs to know. The world needs to know so they wake up. They wake up that this is real. They're being bamboozled. They're being deceived. They're being herded like lemmings into a destiny that they, when they land there, they will not be able to get out. It is true. It is true. It is a herald. It is the herald of a voice crying out, you know, like a prairie dog to the whole population. It's true. The demons are real. It's true. The predator is there. It's going to slay everyone if you don't wake up. It is true. All the warnings in the Bible about these rulers, these powers that are working to capture people, to rob their crown of life, working behind the scenes, unseen. It's real. This is not a fantasy. You know, people think because they haven't seen it, they haven't seen it, known anything about it, you know, and maybe even some of their leaders tell them, you know, the things of the days of the Bible, you know, that was then, but it's not now. And even that, some have been taught even false doctrines that this is symbolic. So it's symbolic evil. It was symbolic that the Lord's talking about it. No, it's literal. So to that end, now I'm going to share with you what happened to me. It happened to me a little over 4 years ago, March 9th, 2013. And I'm going to put some the little bit of graphics I made, the best I can, to really share what I went through. Now, this was not near-death experience. It was not a dream. At the time that I had it, it was almost noon. I was lying in bed. I was not asleep. I had a mask over my eyes because, you know, there was a lot of light. I was just lying there. And to give it justice, I'm going to read the account that I put as part of my book. I just want to say before I begin, you know, as long as the Lord has me here in this world, I will try to keep relating this experience and relating my other encounters that I've had. They're not trite. It's not trivial. It's not yesterday's news. It's essential experiences that bring home the reality of the warnings in the Bible, the warnings that at this point, every one of us here serve a positive purpose. If there's a positive purpose to examine all the warnings, all the threats to us, you know, you can't just go walking around with your head in the sand and ignore it, because what awaits is so brutal. It is so fierce, so unbearable. You need to do something while you can do something about it. This is the only time you can do anything about it. There is no complacency about it. It's so grievous. It's so grievous. All the myriads of people who have been captured in their minds by the enemy to pay no heed. Just tra-la-la. Tra-la-la. Till they pass away. And then they face the reality they were able to deny and are kept in darkness by the enemy until that point. It's too serious. What I went through, what I have gone through, is not a dream. It's not to be brushed off. And a lot of people just don't want to have their lovely lives disturbed. Their lovely outings, their lovely daily rituals, where they can live in delusions of loveliness, just narrowing it to the world. And it's so much worse now, because you know, before television, all the time, and going all the way back, man has always been behaving wickedly since the Garden of Eden. It's just been wickedness. But it's really much worse. It's global scale because of the television and this communication method the enemy has to brainwash and to hold in its command. People, the way they think, mold them. So people want to be irritated by anything that bothers them from their fantasy existence. But it is it's an emergency. It's an emergency for every person to wake up and to know about the danger so they can take action to avoid the deadly harm targeting just for them. Each and every person is being targeted and in deadly threat. Alright, let me begin this. I cannot speak this. I cannot say it. Enough. I can't say it enough. God help me. To say this with the power that it needs to be said. To grab some of those people from the fire. Snatch them out of the fire. Snatch them out from that demonic enemy that has such brutal plans. This enemy has brutal plans. Off the charts. Okay. March 9th, 2013. This is the book that it's in. Now, you know, the enemy would like to get people to turn from this message saying, oh, she's pushing a book. Well, you know what, people? I'm not pushing a book. I don't go on any talks about it. I don't go anywhere. I haven't even sold one for like a year or two or something because I am just not pushing or plugging it. It takes work to sell a book. And being on YouTube, you don't get, when you go on YouTube just to look at, watch videos about people, how much they make on the ads of YouTube, you're going to learn the statistics of the amount of people that you need to have in order to move something. And it's in the numbers of thousands. I have very few subscribers, you know, and this is not enough. So this is nothing to do with it. And I rebuke the devil trying to harden the people at this point to say, oh, Now just listen to this, please. Do your soul a favor. Tell that enemy to get behind you. March 9th, 2013. I lay in bed on my stomach, head to the left. You know what? I may try this without my glasses because I see there's a little bit of a glare. Sorry, people. That helps me be even more fuzzy. Okay. March 9th, 2013. I lay in bed on my stomach, head to the left. As I lay there, it was like a communication channel was switched open. Of all the experience I have had in my life, this was new. It seemed the Holy Spirit opened this communication frequency long enough for me to listen to a conversation about 2 feet from my ear so I could know exactly how threatened the demonic kingdom felt about something I was part of, which unknown to me coincided with the date I would finish this book exactly 1 year later in 2014 on March 9th. A male demonic voice spoke exceedingly angry, super angry, to unseen listeners to his right, very close. I couldn't quite understand what he said, but I knew what he spoke about, as if it was revealed to me, much the way someone can interpret tongues. It was as if Satan himself came personally to point out the threat, point out that I was close to making something happen that was a threat to them, something that would tip the war in a very threatening way to them. And he was highly upset the situation had gotten to where it was. Now I just want to say, and this is not, I'm not reading this, at this point I was doing nothing for Jesus. I was in the process even to understanding about, just beginning to, about holiness and dressing. I had no knowledge. You know, at this point, I didn't have plans to do anything. I was just trying to deal with fighting the foreclosure in my house. If it was not Satan himself, it was a high-ranking ruler in his kingdom from the authority in his voice. Let me tell you what that voice sounded like. It was not human to begin with, yet it was distinctly manlike in that it spoke words like people, but it was demonic and of a big monster-like being, monstrous in that its voice had a peculiar resonance and depth like a giant would, but a monster giant that spoke with evil in his entire voice. Now you see, giant monster. So when that Philippa spoke about how gigantic that demon was, and she was so caught up by that, and she was questioning the Lord about it, I said, wow, this is the thing that I experienced. This ruler was gigantic. He was a monster. I mean, I'm telling you, this is happening real life to me, 2 feet from my ear. The phenomenon of the voice was precisely like the Lord of Darkness demon played by Tim Curry in the 1985 film titled Legend, as far as the strange depth resonating special effects given to Tim Curry's voice to make him sound like a large monster demon. Except the voice I heard was far older, comparing Curry's demon like a young man to this voice being senior, not as in feeble senior, but in very much potent, but a very mature, advanced age male, like a high general, seasoned, mature being. The demon's voice spoke of girth, like an elephant has girth. It spoke of tremendous size. I'm telling you, this was 2 feet from my ear. Its voice conveyed this was a being that if he held me, I would be like a small poodle in his hand. He could hold me with one hand. I'm not talking one arm. I'm talking one hand. He could actually put his hand around my torso and hold me like a small dog because he was that big. From what that voice spoke of, the size of the creature behind that huge voice. Actually, this demon had to be about 30 feet in height or 30 to 50 feet wide from the resonating volume of its voice. What I would have seen if I had turned, which I was getting the distinct information not to, who knows what? Maybe I would have seen something very shocking to look at, besides being in trouble that it would see me looking at it. Something too shocking for me to look at and not freak out, which may have been the reason I was giving the distinct impression spiritually not to look, even peek, but stay lying there, playing possum as I was, keeping my eyes shut. So it probably no doubt had to be supernaturally within my room, since it was talking about 2 feet away from my head and had to have been hunched over. If I had been dumb enough to disregard the unspoken warning coming to me not to turn and look, I might have seen the front half of its body leaning through my ceiling and wall, its giant demon head down to me to talk to the smaller, normal size as far as human-sized demons, and just talking right at me as it spoke about me, saying these orders, saying this information that it was really highly upset about. I really want to take the moment to convey to you in full what hearing its voice was like, so you have a more proper understanding of what this demon commander really was like. The chest it had to have to give such a giant's voice most certainly was larger than any elephant on this earth, because this voice I heard, again 2 feet from my ear, had a tremendous resonance of a monster giant. I mean, this is something I can't even tell you, you know, go to the zoo and get 2 feet to an elephant and let him trumpet at your ear, because this wasn't enough. The creature you'd have to go to is not alive now. It's a Tyrannosaurus Rex. You know, you'd have to go find a giant beast that high and have it go 2 feet from your ear, and only then could you understand how you can't mistake what you're hearing. You can't mistake such a thing, okay? It's nothing to do with imagination. There was no comparison to such a voice I have heard in my life, not even an elephant's trumpeting that I've heard live at zoos. However, if a T-Rex could talk, that might have been what it sounded like as far as this big chest resonance and power of the voice, like the legend demon performed by Tim Curry, but right in the room with me and not through some stereo speakers, which really can't capture the true volume and girth conveyed in that giant's voice. So you can go on the internet now and you can find a 1985 legend movie and you can watch the scenes with Tim Curry walking around like a demon. Your stereos will not be able to replicate the reality of what I heard. It's not the same. The reality is different. You know, you've gone to the zoo, have you heard a lion roar? That is so much more than what your TV can do for you. Getting back to the demon commander raging next to my ear. First of all, he raged like he was super upset I had gotten to the point where I was. It was a fury panic. If you can imagine a monster voice going on like that. As I said, He spoke in a language not of this world. I made no sense of any of the words, none similar to any language we know on earth. Yet, as I said, the Spirit gave me a knowing of the conversation, like instant understanding as this demon general raged. I use the word general and commander interchangeably because I knew, the same way as I was given understanding of the contents of what he was saying, that he was a top power, though I cannot say if he really was Satan or who, but definitely top. As I had my head turned away from him, my eyes covered with the sleep mask I usually wear, so seeing was not something I could do, even if I had been dumb enough to disregard this supernatural understanding, not to do so while this took place, besides my own common sense to keep them close. In addition to the knowing not to look, I had the understanding his presence was there because the problem was big enough that he had to come in person himself to deal with it personally. He was going off the walls, hyper upset, just 2 feet from my ears. He was a combination of hyper upset and panic. Then I understood he was giving commands to wreak destruction on me. At the same time, it was like they could not touch me, as if I was in some kind of protection, which had to be the Holy Spirit who was giving me this whole protected experience while I understood to just play possum like I was sleeping. Through the same kind of indirect knowing, I got the information this commander was barking orders to a group of hit demons, not just one. Somehow, this knowing conveyed to me these demons listening in total respect to this ballistic commander were not monsters in size themselves, but like people size and smaller, and several were there. The big giant commander was over my head as I lay in bed, my face turned away, and his henchmen were further out to the room, to the foot of the bed. The information this demon was giving to those listening was something those listening didn't even know. I heard about 8 seconds, then the channel was switched off. Almost as if the Holy Spirit did not want me to know the details so I would not be overcome and faint from that. It seemed that I had been tuned in to the pertinent part to get the essential summary. Then later when I got up, I got hit with several overwhelming troubles from before breakfast to after dinner. Once clearly meant to do me in or drive me over the edge. The important part of my sharing these problems that hit me and continue to hit me is so you can see how the enemy does warfare and get some understanding about some negative things which might be happening to you as well, and put those troubles into the right perspective and know how to overcome them and endure against them. Now you see, that's the end I'm sharing here. After I had went to something like that, and you can see the majority of my description here was based on the size, the tremendousness, the giganticness of this demon. Well, when I heard Philipa Kuranchie going on about, she was stunned. She was wondering, how is this demon so big? So tremendous, so big. And she had to ask the Lord this, Lord, why is it so big? And the Lord explained to her, because he's worshipped so. He's worshipped. This particular demon is the demon of God, of money. He's so worshipped. I don't know the actual ruler that came there. I don't know, because, like I said, the Holy Spirit was keeping me from looking. And I believe now if I looked, I might actually kill her. I don't know what. Maybe not kill, but It was just not good. It was not good. I was not spiritually ready. I hadn't had no biblical understanding and training and things to do that probably I could withstand such a thing. That's all I know. But the point is that this is like spot on to what she was talking about. I pray that you are strengthened from this in your walk, that you're strengthened, that you're built up to just keep that armor on and just understand that we're in a battle. We're in a battle, and we have to endure to the end. Endure to the end. When the Lord spoke in the Bible, he's telling the saints to endure. He's not saying, oh, you have an easy ride. Don't worry, I'll come. You know, just keep the faith. No, it is spoken, but we are waging war. That their war is being waged against us, and that those who endure to the end will get the crown of life.